Yo, what up, man? Chris Unbiased checking in, man, here with the man of the hour. Got my boy ARP. What's good, man?
Yes, sir. My guy, we back as always. What's good with you, man? Chilling. Same shit, different day.
We got to talk about this max out, too, man. One thing I noticed, I just want to get your thoughts on this real quick, is that it's a pretty quick turnaround. Is that the way RBE is going to be moving forward? Because basically, we started hearing about max out, too, even before, probably around the time the second release, the A Ward and Ill Will, and normally we don't hear about the next card that fast. So
yeah,
what was the thoughts behind that?
Yeah, nothing's super strategic, and it's crazy for me to say no, even though there's already some stuff happening for Max Out Part 3. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? So that sounds like a fucking contradiction, but the truth is, like, I said this before, like, we like to pick our spots. Like, we sit back, we look at the scene. The momentum of Max Out 1 played a heavy part of it. There's a lot of people on the card that want to get right back to work. The fan base, the turnout, the crowd there, you know, being in Believe like that, the timing. A lot of that just pushed it. And I come out of every card saying the same shit, like, no vacation mode, because it'd be so much work leading into those damn events. Vacation mode, when they sit back, relax, take my mind off battle rap for a little bit. But, you know, even from the other side, like the battle rappers, people have no clue how many battles start to initiate because the battlers, they have no clue, man. Like, let's say you all of a sudden you got a Loaded Lux calling you saying, like, yo, man, I'm trying to battle in July. You know, it's not easy to put that call down and start saying, all right, let's formulate a card in an event. You know what I mean? Like, there was battles that started to become in the works for Max, that's not even on the card, but started to come into the works and had some heavy talks around them. Whether they get moved to Max Out 3 or not, that really got the gears rolling. You know what I'm saying? So that's really how it is for us. We don't pick a month. We just start to feel the vibe, the energy, the timing, and then we start getting to work. It's hard for us to sit totally down. Like, we get into the slow lane and shit starts pulling us right over. You know what I mean? So it's just picking our spots, sit back, look at the game and say, maybe it does work to come right back and do Max Out Part 2. That's how that works.
I asked this question when we were doing the whole Max Out Part 1 rollout, that I'm probably going to keep asking, because, you know, me and you get the same tweets. Sometimes they at me and at you about why so-and-so isn't on the card. I thought it was going to be this person. I thought it was going to be that person.
Yeah.
So I'm always curious. I'm sure fans probably want to know, how hard is it to actually do some of these events and do some of these cards? You know, we live in an era of contracts, lying battlers, a whole bunch of other stuff that goes on. Is it really frustrating putting these cards together with expectation versus reality?
Yeah, the reality of it is it's a whole new ball game. Like, what people see is an eight-hour show. You know what I'm saying? It takes months of work, months and months of work to create that 7-8-hour show. Yeah, I mean, that's really the end result. That's the package that everybody ends up seeing and getting. You know, they see some edited battles or whatever. I get those DMs and tweets all the time, too. Yo, ARP, add this to the card. Yo, ARP, do this. Yo, ARP, set this up. They don't know if this battler wants too much money, or this battler isn't battling right now, or this battle is booked already, or this battle declined the match already. I get asked for so many things that can't happen. You know what I'm saying? They just don't know. You know what I mean? So, like, to answer the question, it's extremely hard. Think about it like this, too. What battle rappers wouldn't love to cut all these middlemen out? And I support it when people still do it. Like, I don't care, you know what I mean? But if you could do a full all-out event that generates the likes of, like, let's say a Max Out Part 1 without the league, you know what I'm saying? Then everybody would be doing it. Everybody would be cutting out the middleman, or be cutting out the platform, or be cutting out the league. Some of these battle rappers have had, you know, moments of success, but then you also have a lot of battle rappers that have tried ventures and they saw the hard way of, like, what's really involved, you know. And you got to keep pressing at it. I think that the battlers that's interested in getting events done, or even if it's a new league owner or a new platform owner.
I'm the energy, and I represent battle rap and the culture. All these niggas I got in here represent the battle rap and the culture. These niggas is the energy. You don't need no league. The leagues need us. If it's not for us, no leagues don't exist, my nigga.
If you're interested in it, then do it. Take it forward. But you better understand that it's in the same lane of any type of business. Like, the first X amount of months, or sometimes even X amount of years, you will be taking a loss. That's how it is to be an entrepreneur. that's how it is to start a business. You think that starting a store, whether it's a sneaker store or a fucking shirt store, whatever, you don't have to take your losses and find your sponsorships and crack into the market and build up your following and build up your social media and all that types of shit and your platform and recognition and spend your money and up your quality. All of these things, you think it has to be done in all these other areas, but not in battle rap? You know what I'm saying? Battle rap is no different. Yeah, I mean, it's just an entertainment field. So there's a reason why, you know, a movie on HBO or Showtime or whatever might get a little bit more notoriety. It's because that platform has been built up. You know, I learned that even, you know, being around HBO for some time. Like, if you look at my Instagram, that's where pictures like me and Floyd Mayweather come in. Me and Oscar De La Hoya come in or whatever. I did consulting with them for quite some time. I learned a lot about marketing and a lot about promotions. And one thing that they say a lot is, like, you look at, like, The Sopranos. People used to go to HBO directly and kill them for the way Sopranos ended. Why end like this? Not knowing that HBO is just a platform. They didn't write that script. You know what I'm saying? Like, somebody, you have the Tom Hankses of the world or whatever that, like, write these movies or write these series or write these scripts, and then they go to HBO or Showtime or whatever, and they say, look what I got. They go to Netflix and say, look what I got. And then those platforms pick it up. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, people got to understand the realities of what's involved with these things and what it takes to put these things together, and not just put them together, but keep them moving forward. Like, here's a good one for you. Like, I had this debate sometimes with Mook. You know what I mean? Shout out to my nigga Mook. Like, we'll get on the phone, we'll talk about, like, who's done what for the other person. It's like an ego debate that we've always had for, like, since 2018. Like, he'll talk his shit sometimes. Like, yo, if it wasn't for me, you don't know what type of artist might be interested in coming to RBE after me. We'd be like, nigga, if it wasn't for us, you might not be back in battle rap, period. Like, you was minding your business for 4 years. We called you and offered you the amount of money that nobody was offering you and brought you back to the game. And that was our idea. So we have valid points, I guess, on both sides, right? But one debate that I always had back to Woop is in that respect of what he says, like, look at the people that come after me. You still have to maintain it. Like, after we book Mook, yeah, the momentum is there, and we turn around and we do Shape Mills, kind of in the same theme of a return. Then you see Hollow, you see Hitman vs. Bill Collector, etc. Then you saw a drop-off. You know what I'm saying? Like, by the time we, after we did the Hitman vs. Bill Collector, after that, we went into the Math vs. Serious card. Card was not well-received at all. You know what I'm saying? People didn't like that. After that card, in battle rap, with the fucking... with the energy going up and down so fast, you had people saying that it's it for them. They fell off, you know, we're done, we're off RBE. One card, one event. And after that, we did Ladies and Gents. We thought we was being a little bit creative as far as what RBE has been doing over the years. That wasn't a big card. Nobody was crazy about that. You know, you mixing your Blood, Sweat, and Tears cards, your Ladies and Gents cards, your Math vs. Serious cards or whatever, and they off you. They off you. Your momentum's gone. Your viewership is gone. Your views are down. All types of shit. So the energy, the financing, the promotion, the work that it takes to not only jump your platform up to a certain level, but keep it there.
Okay, so we had Max Out One, and I didn't done a couple blogs about this, but I want to get your opinion of that. I couldn't really figure out, because I know you was in the building and I know you saw the guy bring in the fire signs and whatever whatever was flipped over. He had
the trash
signs
and the fire.
Yeah, and I couldn't really gather with the crowd whether it was just an industry crowd because Cassie was a part of it. Was it just so, you know, we've been locked up for the quarantine for so long, we just happy to be out. What was your take on the crowd at night? You done been on stage, a lot of people got booed. It was like, you know, great if you was able to survive without getting a little bit of negative backlash. What's your take on these battle rap crowds? Do you feel like this is what we're gonna see, or it was an aberration?
I think all of the above. I think you got a little bit of everything in there. I think you got some of the people that was just like, wow, battle rap crowds are back. Thank you, RBE. And actually, shout out to Bullpen, too. They did a big crowd a couple weeks before Max Out.
And speak on the Atlanta backlash. Like, some people just felt, okay.
Yeah, definitely. So shout out to John, Bullpen, Will, everybody over there. But yeah, you got some people there that's like, yo, big crowds are back, battle rap. We used to love being at live crowds, and we lost it. So, you know, they wanted to be there for that. Then the fact you can't take nothing away from the card, and then all the way to the top of Cassidy versus Hitman as the main event. People want to see that live. You know what I'm saying? Like, they want to see that shit. The promotion, which we always push the battlers to do, because that's how you end up having these big events. Even the views of your battle will be higher if you promote your battle. So you got shit like the face-off, you know, Cassidy versus Hitman face-off going viral. Jag went lit up on his promotion. He had even Old Red promoting out there. Rosenberg Raw show off, they went to champion. A-Ward did his thing. Ill Will, you know, he'd be a little bit quiet at times, but you know, Ill Will just got his own draw regardless. So forth and so on. Shout out to Big K, definitely as well. But yeah, that element. So all those elements, you could say the some industry people. Yeah, there was some semi-celebs and people that was, you know, talking about it, that wanted to be there and promoting it. So yeah, you got a mix of everything. And you're going to get that again for Max Out Part 2, probably. Now, the backlash of the Atlanta crowd is no different than when we was doing Music Room, which is so funny. Now, I mean, like, people, they have short memories. I always say that shit. Sometimes they was booing in the Music Room, which was like 200, 250 people, similar to, like, Club Drum. You know what I mean? Same type of outcome in Believe Music Hall. It's just that it's stronger because there's more people there. And I think the Believe Music Hall or the Atlanta crowd, it's got a little bit of that New York effect to it where they could be standoffish to you at times. But one thing I like is that they always start on high energy for every battle. You know what I'm saying? When you see Rosenberg Raw and Show Off walk out on stage, the crowd goes crazy. When you see their first rounds, the crowd is just super engaged, you know. And it's like, if I was a battle rapper, I wouldn't be missing this. If your rounds dive down, the crowd starts to get disengaged. They start to chatter. They start to have less patience for your setups and how if your punches land or not. You know what I'm saying? Like, the impact of A-Ward's first round is stronger than his third round. Even though his material in his third round, he had way more angles that was going at Ill Will, doing schemes and all types of shit in his third round, creativity, pulling out the mask and doing all this type of shit that he was doing. It's just that a crowd, you know, you have to construct your rounds in such a way, especially in certain cities, where you never let them drop off. You just can't let them drop off. You can't skate on any of your rounds and any of your material. Write your rounds, see if there's any filler, and take the shit out.
What's your thoughts on booing? Do you say fair game or
No. I hate booing in any city. Okay. I hated booing in New York. You know what I'm saying? Now you get less of it when there's only 250 people in front of you, or 300 people in front of you in Club Drum. You get less of it. You know what I'm saying? But I hate booing in any city, including Atlanta. I feel like we need to give these people the room to operate. This is fresh material that they've made up for that particular event. You know what I'm saying? If you don't fuck with something, just be quiet. Just be quiet. You know what I mean? But at the same time, you want to let people enjoy their money, spend their hard-earned money to come out and enjoy a show. And that's what separates some battlers.
Do you feel any pressure as the host to kind of
stop
the booze?
Nope.
Hold it down. Or just keep it, you know.
Not pressure. I wouldn't say I feel pressure. I feel an obligation sometimes to help out as the host with the microphone. I don't feel pressure. And the reason why I don't feel pressure is because I've been seeing battlers come in there and not get a single boo. Rosenberg Raw didn't get a single boo in his three rounds. One is K's. Nobody got booed. Who else? Ill Will didn't get booed.
Yeah, that was kind of amazing. The one that's case did not get booed at all.
but this is what I'm saying. Like, I seen battlers in big crowds shut down some of these big events, and there's not a single boo, there's not a single dead point or whatever. So what does that show you about the rounds and what the battle did? Like, if you see Cass or Hitman get booed at certain times of their rounds, right? Does that mean you just put all that bad credit on the crowd? And then you take away the credit from somebody like a Rosenberg Raw or Ill Will that doesn't get a single boo when they come with those type of rounds? That's not fair to do to the battle. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. So that's why I don't feel no pressure. Because I know that there's certain performances that'll get up there and it could be 5,000 people in front of us. No. It's just going to be an epic moment depending on what these guys write and what they execute. So I don't feel that type of pressure.
Okay.